Guten Abend and good evening to all of you. On behalf of the Heinz von Foerster Society, I would like to welcome you to this year's very much reduced Heinz von Foerster conference in the format of a single lecture. And we were unable to continue this rhythm of the two-year conferences, but we want to keep alive the tradition of Heinz von Foerster lectures, and it's close to his birthday, and it's November, and here we are. There are at least three very good reasons to invite Stuart Umpleby for a Heinz von Foerster lecture. On the one hand, Stuart Umpleby is one of the most prolific and interesting cyberneticians who worked in this field for decades now and who produced a lot of very interesting things on cybernetics, on demographic change, on scientific cooperation, and so on. So, and he was past president of the, or is past president of the American Society of Cybernetics, so it's one of the living cyberneticians around, and there are not few of this species anymore. So that's one of the good reasons to invite Stuart Umpleby. The second reason is he knew Heinz von Foerster probably longer and from different perspectives than any one of us here. Stuart studied at the University of Illinois, where he learned about Heinz von Foerster, was visiting his lectures, and Heinz von Foerster was his PhD supervisor. So he worked together with him and from the early 1970s onward, and that's probably not something anyone else in this group could say. And the third very good reason is that Stuart could help us to unravel some mystery. Stuart was part of this student group which produced an immensely interesting book in the year 1974 with the title of Cybernetics of Cybernetics. And if you ever come across this book, it's really very impressive. It's very big, with a lot of interesting contents, arrangements, and so on. It's some sort of a cybernetic encyclopedia. And on the first page, on the front page, the book says, first order cybernetics, cybernetics of systems observed. And second order cybernetics is cybernetics of observing systems. And one has the expectation that in this book you find a lot about the distinction between first and second order cybernetics, or a lot about second order cybernetics for that matter, but there's only a single article, a two-page article in the entire book, and this was written by Stuart on second order cybernetics. So maybe that's the third good, very good reason to invite you. Maybe you can tell us more about second order cybernetics and why so little is on this extremely interesting book on cybernetics of cybernetics. So, welcome to Stuart, and curious what you have to present to us. Thank you.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, it is a great honor to be here today to address you about the work of my friend and mentor, Heinz von Foerster, whose birthday is nearby, and my friend and colleague, Carl Mueller, who also has the same birthday. So it's an auspicious occasion. That was a wonderful question. I'll be thinking about that as I present my remarks, and we can come to that at the end. Okay, so that's probably the most well-known picture of Heinz. Here's some others. As you know, I assume most of you are here are reasonably familiar with Heinz von Foerster. He's well known for many contributions: the mechanism of memory, an equation describing population growth, a thought experiment illustrating self-organization, neurophysiological evidence illustrating individual construction of a reality, and a radical view of ethics. The theme of my talk is that there's a sort of larger contribution that Heinz made. And that is that he showed us how to expand the scientific enterprise when circumstances require, not just contribute to a specific field. So I propose to explain how Heinz did that and how that idea is being followed up today. Because second-order cybernetics provides an example of how to expand the scientific enterprise. In a sense, it provides an example of a scientific revolution within the philosophy of science. Now, Heinz's goal was to include the observer in the domain of science. That's the way he presented it. And just to be clear at the beginning, when I speak to physicists about second-order cybernetics and including the observer, they often think of the Heisenberg uncertainty principle, which is understandable. But that's not what Heinz meant by including the observer. Events at the atomic level are quite different from the biology of cognition, and Heinz was interested in the biology of cognition. Heinz was greatly influenced by Warren McCulloch. Both McCulloch and von Foerster wanted to understand cognition. McCulloch invented the term experimental epistemology, namely testing epistemological theories through neurophysiological research. In philosophy, there's the field of epistemology. Within epistemology, there are a variety of epistemologies, and the question was, which one is more accurate? And McCulloch thought, let's look at the brain, see what it does. That will tell us which epistemology fits the best. Very creative idea, I think. That's Warren McCulloch. And that's what McCulloch's work was devoted to, experimental epistemology. His articles are in the book Embodiments of Mind, which I think has recently been reissued. Now, following World War II, there was excitement about the utility of applied science. And one outgrowth of that excitement, because there were many scientific projects related to the war effort going on during the war, the Josiah Macy Jr. Foundation conferences in New York City were held in 1946 to 1953. They were chaired by Warren McCulloch, although Bateson and Mead seemed to have been very influential in getting them going. The title of those conferences was Circular Causal and Feedback Mechanisms in Biological and Social Systems. And they were attended by a number of well-known people. And they were both influential at the time and continued to be influential in later years. Heinz was among the youngest of the group. Warren McCulloch saw his article on the mechanism of memory and invited Heinz to join the group. I think McCulloch also found him a position at the University of Illinois in Urbana-Champaign. McCulloch, I think, at the time was at the University of Illinois in Chicago and then later moved to MIT. I came to know Heinz by hearing him speak on campus. Heinz was an extremely entertaining lecturer. And so he was often invited to lectures. And one of the lectures that I remember was a faculty meeting. There were faculty throughout the university that met for lunch at least once a month. And there was a sort of ante room where students could sit and listen. And Heinz was speaking to this group. And he made a bold forecast. He says, in the future, human beings will discover three things. First, the earth is finite, meaning human population cannot grow indefinitely, which was a new idea at the time. Second, power resides where information resides. It's from McCulloch. And then, A is better off when B is better off. Now, you can debate whether we've learned those things yet, but we're on our way. I later mentioned that presentation to Heinz, and he did not remember it. And he said, well, I was just trying to be amusing. But I thought it was prescient. So as a result of hearing Heinz speak and Ross Ashby speak, Ashby spoke and mentioned Bremerman's limit, which to me connected up matter, energy, and information, which hadn't been connected before in my mind. And so I decided I needed to find out what was going on at this place called the Biological Computer Laboratory. And that was fairly easy to do. Heinz had a board on top of a radiator, on top of the heater, and whenever there was a new reprint, he would put a stack of reprints on this board. It was in his secretary's office. And so I would just swing through the front office from time to time and look at the articles and pick them up and read them. And when I had questions, I would ask Heinz. And he would answer the question, but then he would talk about his own work. And frankly, I thought Heinz was a little odd. He was more cheerful, more enthusiastic, more energetic than anybody I'd ever met. And also, he wanted to include the observer in science, which I figure, well, okay, he doesn't understand the philosophy of science. This is odd for a professor, but the rest of what he said sounded interesting. So, when I first heard Heinz talking about the role of the observer, it sounded to me a lot like what Thomas Kuhn said in The Structure of Scientific Revolutions. For example, there's this quote: "The proponents of competing paradigms practice their trades in different worlds. One contains constrained bodies that fall slowly. The other, pendulums that repeat their motions again and again." There's some other examples. "Practicing in different worlds, the two groups of scientists see different things when they look at the same point in the same direction. Again, that is not to say they can see anything they please. Both are looking at the world, and what they look at has not changed. But in some areas, they see things differently, and they see them in different relations one to another. That is why a law that cannot even be demonstrated to one group of scientists may occasionally seem intuitively obvious to another. Equally, it is why, before they can hope to communicate fully, one group or the other must experience the conversion that we have been calling a paradigm shift," like a gestalt shift. So I showed that quote to Heinz, and Heinz said, "No, that's not what I'm talking about." Soon thereafter, he gave a lecture in the Department of Electrical Engineering and published the article "On Constructing a Reality," which contains a number of neurophysiological experiments. And then I made the paradigm shift. I had been listening to Heinz for some time. I didn't get it, but after that article, the pieces fell into place, and I thought, this is really interesting, and this is an opportunity to make a scientific revolution. So I thought, okay, so that's what we'll do. We'll go out and we'll make a scientific revolution to introduce this idea to the scientific community. And if you're not familiar with these neurophysiological experiments, that to me is the most persuasive way of understanding the point. The blind spot, etc. I won't go through those now, but if you want, I'll go through them later. The meaning of these experiments is that the brain does a great deal of work for us that we are not aware of. For example, on your retina, I'm upside down, simply due to optics. And that's just one of many examples, that what we see and hear is not always there. In other words, the blind spot, we don't see a black hole because the brain fills things in for us. So our senses are fallible. And the conclusion is that observations independent of the characteristics of the observer are not physically possible, which is quite different from what is assumed in the philosophy of science. So by 1975, about the time that Cybernetics was published, there were a number of achievements. McCulloch had defined and developed experimental epistemology. Bateson was doing work on schizophrenia, the double bind, and numerous other things. Wiener's concept of a second industrial revolution was widely known. There was rapid growth of computers and robotics. There was some work being done by artists and composers. Heinz did some work on computer music. Herbert Brunn was working on artistic and musical compositions. Maturana's concept of autopoiesis was attracting considerable attention as a way of defining life, and work on second-order cybernetics was just beginning. However, the money ran out. The reason the money ran out was because of something called the Mansfield Amendment. In the early 70s, there was turmoil on college campuses in the United States. And Congress wanted to cool the campuses. One of the causes of the turmoil was that a lot of research on campuses was funded by the Department of Defense, and students were opposed to the Vietnam War. So Mansfield, who was a liberal Democrat Senate Majority Leader, proposed the Mansfield Amendment that required all DOD funding to have a military mission. That meant that Heinz, who was getting money from the Office of Scientific, the Air Force Office of Scientific Research and the Naval Research Lab, had to declare what was the military mission of his research, and he says there was none. So he couldn't get any more money from the people who understood his work. People in the artificial intelligence labs at MIT, Stanford, Carnegie Mellon, over coffee, invented the concept of an electronic battlefield to justify their work in AI and robotics. And that went over very well, both in the Pentagon and in Congress. And so the money shifted from cybernetics and AI to basically AI and robotics. And there were numerous other efforts to find funding for BCL, but basically they weren't successful. And so the laboratory was closed in 75. Heinz retired and moved to California. I graduated and moved to George Washington University. So we didn't have that in-present nucleus at the Biological Computer Laboratory at the University of Illinois. And many scholars sort of circulated through there. Maturana, Varela, Lars Lofgren, Stafford Beer, and others would visit Heinz at Illinois, and I was able to meet them since I was there. So in the late 1970s, we kind of reconstructed the network via cyberspace. This was the early days of experiments with electronic media. There was the Electronic Information Exchange System, EIS, at New Jersey Institute of Technology. And there were several experimental trials of small research communities using this electronic media, funded by the National Science Foundation. And I had one of those grants, so I got the BCL people into cyberspace in the late 70s. Also, the American Society for Cybernetics, which had been founded in 1964, it's now going to celebrate its 50th anniversary in August, so I want to invite all of you to attend in Washington, D.C., the American Society for Cybernetics meeting. It had passed through a period of inactivity, and it was revived. So in addition to the electronic messaging and collaboration and co-authoring of papers, etc., we began to hold meetings. And during these conferences, we would have tutorials before the conference on second-order cybernetics. We also did that for the EMCSR conferences in Vienna, the conferences in Amsterdam, and elsewhere. And people like Pask and Glanville and me organized symposia and presented tutorials. Von Foerster, von Glasersfeld, Maturana, and Varela were leading speakers. Here's Pat. And basically what we were trying to do was to introduce the notion of second-order cybernetics. And everybody defined it differently. There are many different... These were some of the definitions that were used at the time. Von Foerster, cybernetics of observed systems versus cybernetics of observing systems. Pass, the purpose of a model versus the purpose of a modeler. Varela, controlled systems versus autonomous systems. I was in social science, so I was thinking of interaction among the variables in a system versus interaction between observer and observed, or theories of social systems versus theories of the interaction between ideas and society. Varela told me that what I was talking about wasn't second-order cybernetics, and he told me I should study more biology. So I came to make a distinction between biological cybernetics and social cybernetics, figuring there was engineering cybernetics, then biological cybernetics, and social cybernetics. And to me, that's the sort of emphasis that characterized the period from 1950 through the 1990s. Now, after a number of years of presenting tutorials on the differences between first-order cybernetics and second-order cybernetics, and trying to make a scientific revolution, it seemed to me that we needed to change our strategy, that we needed to go beyond repeatedly defining differences. And I thought the correspondence principle might help. I'll explain in a minute. Kuhn and Popper both mentioned the correspondence principle, but didn't use it much. Heinz told me about the correspondence principle, but he also didn't use it much himself. But think of things this way. Kuhn said, you have normal science, puzzle solving, then you have a revolutionary period, then you have normal science, then a revolutionary period, and then normal science. And so you can obviously present that as a cycle. The way you make the transition from normal science to a scientific revolution is through incommensurable definitions, like the differences between first-order cybernetics and second-order cybernetics. But then the question is, how do you get back to a period of normal science? And the answer, I think, is you have to reformulate the issue in terms of the correspondence principle, which Kuhn doesn't talk about very much. He mentions it, but he mostly focuses on incommensurable definitions. So the correspondence principle was proposed by Niels Bohr when they were developing the quantum theory early in this century, last century. And it says, any new theory should reduce to the old theory to which it corresponds for those cases in which the old theory is known to hold. So basically, you need a new dimension. Think of it this way. So you have the old theory, say Newtonian physics, and then you introduce a new dimension, relative velocity. And then that becomes a new theory. And the new theory reduces to the old theory when relative velocity is very small. Or take the gas laws, where the diameter of particles was considered to be infinitely small. Well, if you compress your gases, pretty soon the diameter begins to be important, so you have to add in the diameter. So you define a dimension that either was neglected or was assumed to be zero. And as a result, all the data that supported the old theory also support the new theory. But since the new theory has added a dimension, you can explain more results. And it seemed to me that what we were doing with second-order cybernetics was adding a dimension to the philosophy of science, not to a specific field like physics or biology, but to the philosophy of science, which in principle would affect all of science, which is more exciting as scientific revolutions go. So, how is cybernetics different from existing fields? Well, most fields of science look for relationships among variables in some observed system. Cybernetics is basically two elements, the regulator and the system being regulated. And there is a circular causal relationship between the two, like the thermostat on the wall and the heater, or a driver of a car in the car, or the manager of a firm in the firm. This is a very general conceptualization, and it can be used for biological and social systems. In biological systems, you have the iris in your eye that controls the light reaching the retina, hunger and eating, thirst and drinking. And this circular causal process between the regulator and the system being regulated involves certain common functions of living systems, like perception, selection, learning, adaptation, etc. Those are common at any level of analysis, from individual to nation state, and so forth. And they can be built into machinery. And they operate within the body. So if we were to adopt cybernetics as a theory and second-order cybernetics as an approach to social systems, which is what I'm primarily interested in and where I think most of the impact lies, what would change? Well, I think that you would use several disciplines when describing a social situation. And you would think in terms of ideas, groups, events, and variables. I'll explain that. And second, there would be interaction between ideas and society, rather than just a description of the relationships between variables. So this comes from Carl Mueller. It's his epigenetic theory, genotype and phenotype, where the genotype is the pattern, the gene, the phenotype is the organism. So you come up with a new pattern, which is embodied in the organism or organization, and some of those organisms survive, some don't, and they go back around, you get another variation in the genotype. So this is a very general concept, works from single-celled organisms all the way up to societies. That fit very well with a conception that I had noticed, which is that if you study systems for any period of time, you begin to note that different disciplines have different basic elements in their systems. The preferred basic element is a variable, like in physics, with mass, length, and time, economics, imports, exports, GDP, savings, etc. But you also have events, like in computer science, do this, do this, do this, do this, or in history, this happened, and this happened, and this happened. And in sociology and political science, the basic unit tends to be groups. You also have ideas as basic elements in psychology, philosophy, cultural anthropology. And if you're interested in the dynamic behavior of the system, there's an interaction between these two. So you have an idea which is embodied in some organism or organization, and then a new idea, and so on. So you have something that looks like this. Ideas, groups, events, variables, happening over time. That, in a sense, describes how social systems change. So that if you're interested in producing some change in a social system, you study the variables, you come up with an idea, you try to persuade other people to go along with it, loan you money, pass some legislation, then you either start a new business, pass some legislation, then you study it with variables to see, okay, what's happening, is it working or not, then you come up with a new idea, and you go around and around on that. So the advantage of using all four methods as opposed to just one, which is what we teach students in universities, we teach them to specialize and only think in terms of psychology or history or something else. If you use each one of these representations, you get a richer description of the social system. Important considerations are less likely to be overlooked, but the theories and methods of more than one discipline are used. I know of only one person who thinks this way, and that's George Soros, who's been very good at understanding social systems. And if you read his book, Alchemy of Finance, he uses all four of these methods in describing a number of different investment situations. The other issue, okay, in addition to thinking in terms of ideas, groups, events, and variables, as we look at social systems to understand the dynamics of social systems, I think we should also look at the interaction between ideas and society. This is a diagram that I made before I read Soros. Soros calls this a shoelace diagram. I think the description fits very well. You could say, okay, there was the First Crusade, there was interest in trade and ancient learning, Marco Polo's trip to China, science and technology are stimulated by a desire to improve trade, traders accumulate wealth and nation-states develop. You have the idea of progress, the Industrial Revolution, Adam Smith's The Wealth of Nations, and so forth. So the idea leads to a different type of social organization. The social organization leads to new ideas, which are embodied in different forms of social organization. The import of this, it seems to me, is that it could change the way we do social science research by not only doing a literature review of what previous scholars have said about the interaction between the various variables, but you could also describe the impact of previous theories on the social system. In other words, if theories affect the social system, which I would claim happens in the social sciences but doesn't happen in the physical sciences, then that should be a part of the study. That a literature review should not just be a review of academic literature, it should look at the consequences of previous theories. Okay, so cybernetics provides a way of studying the impact of science on society, and studies of science and society have, as I understand it, been more empirical than theoretical. So I think this might contribute to an understanding of science and technology studies. Now, lately I've been reading the work of Carl Mueller, and he claims that philosophy of science has become rather inactive in recent years. But meanwhile, things are happening, that there are new trends. We have big science, big data, the internet, and also improved understanding of knowledge, the observer, and epistemology. But the philosophy of science has stayed much the same. And one of my friends in Washington is Mark Noturno, who studied with Popper, who worked with Popper in his last years, helping him accumulate his papers. And Mark thinks philosophy of science ended with Popper. But Carl Mueller is suggesting that cybernetics has taken over the role of the philosophy of science to critique and provide guidance for the creation of scientific theories. And I think he's right, but I hadn't thought of it quite that way. I thought that cybernetics was sort of making a contribution to the philosophy of science, not replacing it. So we'll have to see how that works its way out over time. I think the advantage of reviving the philosophy of science is that departments of philosophy already exist on university campuses. Cybernetics in the United States is not well established. I mean, it hardly exists at all. You don't have courses in cybernetics. You don't have graduate students in cybernetics. So trying to get cybernetics into the philosophy of science would give a base of operations that it would be very difficult to build up, I think, through cybernetics, unless the funding situation changes dramatically. Now, how can cybernetics provide a theory of philosophy as opposed to just influencing philosophy? Well, at a dinner here in Vienna back in November 2005, Carl Mueller had been reading von Foerster's article, Computing in the Semantic Domain. And he said that Heinz had described a triangle that labeled two sides, syntactics and semantics. And he wanted to know, or he wondered, what would the third side be? And I said, pragmatics, American philosophy, of course. So, later, in thinking about the triangle, it occurred to me that the three sides corresponded very well to the three points of view in the history of cybernetics: engineering cybernetics, biological cybernetics, and social cybernetics. So it seemed like the triangle was sort of a way of unifying previously competing epistemologies. Think of it this way. This is Popper's world 1, 2, and 3. So you have world is world 1, world 2 is the observer, world 3 is the description. Engineering cybernetics was primarily number 1. Biological cybernetics was primarily here. Social cybernetics is primarily over there. And in each case, there's an emphasis on two of these issues and a neglect of the third. For example, in the classical philosophy of science, you emphasize creating accurate descriptions of the world, and the observer is excluded. You know, if you do the experiment right, each observer will see the same thing, in principle. And the people interested in cognition said, well, we want to know how the observer works and how the observer produces descriptions. And you really can't be sure about the world because that's all just an internal representation. So if you got the observer in the description, you've got everything. Okay, well, managers are practical people. They want to know how to act in the world. They're not much interested in theory. That's just a distraction. So each epistemology tends to emphasize two variables and neglect the third. But if you put it all together and you say that's second-order cybernetics and first-order cybernetics is over here, then you have an expanded view of epistemology. You sort of have a theory of epistemology. And this is a description of the kinds of things Heinz was working with. And you can see here syntactics, semantics, and pragmatics. And these are a description of the different sides of the triangle. These will be online, so you can look at those later if you want. So in this sense, it seems to me that cybernetics expands science. That's what I just said. So what is the present and the future of cybernetics? Well, at least in the United States, cyber means computers. There's a lot of discussion of cyberspace, cybersecurity, cyber infrastructure. The term cybernetics is not known. It has vanished. People haven't heard of it. So if you just substitute cyber for computers, then people are familiar with what's going on in the computer realm, but they have no idea of the more cognitive, philosophical part of what we call cybernetics. So the computer-oriented disciplines in cybernetics, which don't use the term cybernetics, but would be encompassed by my conception of cybernetics, are things like computer science, artificial intelligence and robotics, system dynamics modeling that Jay Foerster did, the notion of complex adaptive systems, which in my view is an alternative approach to simulation that's basically an enactment of the concept of self-organization as developed by von Foerster and Ashby around 1960, although their work isn't widely known. And most recently, data analytics or big data. This was even on the cover of Foreign Affairs, this very prestigious journal. I assume you all know about the great interest in data analytics simply because in the commercial realm, huge amounts of data are now being collected as a part of the normal business process, whether you're ordering parts or paying your employees or delivering to customers, and that data can all be analyzed for whatever purposes the firm has. But let's look at the more humanistic side, the more philosophical or cognitive side. What is happening there? I am now, by the way, in the realm of second-order cybernetics now, as opposed to second-order cybernetics then. Okay, so I'm trying to define what's happening in second-order cybernetics now and where I think it will be going. So, this group probably knows the book The Beginning of Heaven and Earth Has No Name because it came out in German first. It's going to come out in English soon. I think it's terrific. I think it's a marvelous book. And it shows me that Heinz went way beyond what I had thought he had done. He rethought the physical sciences using his constructivist epistemology. And to me, there are many ideas in there for further research for those who are looking for a career trajectory. I highly recommend it. We also have Carl Miller's interpretation of levels of science and how to do research on multi-level self-referential systems. And Miller's conception of meta-research, the integration of previous studies, and the design of a new kind of doctoral program, which I think is very advanced, very promising, and very exciting. There's also cybernetics in the field of management. Now, the most well-established parts of that are at the University of St. Gallen in St. Gallen, Switzerland, and Malik Consulting Firm that's based on quality improvement methods and Stafford Beer's viable system model and Stafford Beer's Syntegrity work. There's also the work of Russell Aikoff, which is very close, although he used the term the systems approach rather than cybernetics. It's very, very similar to what cyberneticians talk about. There's also the influence of cybernetics in design and architecture. There was a literature on family therapy and psychotherapy, and I assume that's continuing, although it was very exciting at one time when they sort of discovered Maturana and Maturana's work, and I think it's now been absorbed pretty thoroughly. I'm not sure that a lot of innovation is going on there presently. There's also science fiction and literary analysis. Bruno Clark, Catherine Halas, and others are active in that area. There are cognitive studies and consciousness studies, but that literature doesn't include many references to cybernetics, probably the work of Maturana and Varela primarily. And of course, the work of Nicholas Luhmann on sociology and legal studies is popular in Europe. It's not much discussed in the U.S. One body of work that I found very useful, already referred to, is that of George Soros' work on reflexivity theory as an alternative to equilibrium theory in economics. And I could say more about that if anybody's interested. Then there's what I described a moment ago with the ideas, groups, events, variables, which is a multidisciplinary applied approach to the conduct of social research. And then there's the idea of adding two dimensions to the philosophy of science. And I've told you about one dimension, which is including the observer as a dimension you want to add to the philosophy of science. The second dimension would be the amount of effect the theory has on the social system. Either it has no effect or it has a considerable effect. Let me just cite a couple of cases. Presently in the United States, there's a dramatic increase in inequality. The top 1% or 0.01% control a very large fraction of the resources of the country. The middle class income has been stable for about 30 years, not growing at all. This is becoming more of an issue. Just as Al Gore has been promoting the notion of climate change, Robert Reich, who was the Secretary of Labor under Clinton, has a new film out called Inequality for Everyone. So he's using movies to promote an awareness of inequality, just as Gore has been using movies and speeches to promote awareness of climate change. And there's a book, Who Stole the American Dream, by Hedrick Smith, that presents the sequence of laws and Supreme Court decisions very thoroughly. So that change in circumstance was the result of a shift of thinking from stakeholders to stockholders, from thinking about all of the people who have an interest in a firm to saying you only need to focus on shareholders. Milton Friedman promoted that idea, and various business research professors promoted the idea that you want to reward your executives to increase the value of the firm. The way you do that is through stock options, and a consequence of that has been a dramatic increase in inequality in the United States. So that's one example of how you can look at the consequences of an idea. And I think you can add that notion to the philosophy of science, that is, what is the impact of the idea on the phenomenon? When physicists change their thinking from Newtonian mechanics to quantum mechanics, we assume the behavior of atoms continued as it had before, that the theory had no effect on the phenomenon. But in social systems, it does have an effect. So that's an addition to the philosophy of science, where the old philosophy of science works well in the physical domain, but it doesn't work so well in the social domain. So there are three ways of thinking about science. One is that the observer produces a description of what is observed, or you can include the observer, and the observer thinks about himself and what is observed, or you can see a social system as a collection of observers, all of whom are both observing and participating. So they observe and they attempt to influence others, and then people act. And that is a different conception from looking at relationships among a set of variables. That's basically reflexivity theory. Okay, so by providing a general theory of regulation, cybernetics provides a theory of how knowledge is used in social systems. Hence, cybernetics provides what the philosophy of science intended to provide, guidelines for creating scientific knowledge. And cybernetics also provides a theory of science and society. If you look at the papers in economics journals about financial crises, what you will see is linear causal relationships. What are the factors that lead to a financial crisis? Or what are the consequences of a financial crisis? That's the way we train our students, to think in terms of linear causal relationships, maybe with an intervening variable. But if you read the journalistic accounts of what happened during the financial crisis, you get positive and negative feedback loops. You change the law, like eliminating a provision of the Glass-Steagall Act, and you change what was a negative feedback loop, a stable system, into a positive feedback loop, naming a boom and bust cycle. Very simple diagrams to draw. But that boom and bust cycles is not the way economists think in their academic articles. Maybe they think that way when they're testifying before Congress or writing an op-ed piece. They don't think that way when they're doing science. So the contributions of cybernetics, or second-order cybernetics, is that it developed a theory of circular regulatory phenomena, including goal-seeking and goal formulation. It created a theory of perception, learning, cognition, adaptation, etc. It includes the observer within the domain of science, and it created a theory of the use of knowledge in society, or reflexivity. So then and now. Second-order cybernetics, the term second-order cybernetics, is, I think, in part, an effort to tell people that there's more to cybernetics than they think. It's not just thermostats and computers. There's a philosophical and theoretical aspect to it. And because it deals with knowledge in society, there's also more to science than conjectures and refutations and testing propositions to certain levels of statistical significance. And I think that the correspondence principle may be a way of making this point. Because if you take the existing philosophy of science and add two dimensions where you don't discard anything, you just say, I'm going to introduce an additional set of characteristics, of considerations. You preserve what you had before, but you expand what you can explain. All previous research is included in the new point of view and supports the new point of view. So Heinz's contribution, it seems to me, is that he challenged the key assumption underlying the philosophy of science, that is, exclude the observer. He showed that scientific fields can contribute to revising or expanding the philosophy of science. Most just sort of do what they're told. Cybernetics talk back. And he initiated a scientific revolution within the philosophy of science. I'll be glad to take any questions.
And it's time now for questions and criticisms, comments, whatever.
What I would be interested in, what would you think is the impact of second order cybernetics in the field of psychotherapy? Because there it was very prominent for many years, especially in the 80s, and now we don't hear so much, and it's not so much included in the lecture.
Yes, I think it made its contribution to psychotherapy, and family therapy. I mean, it was Bateson and company who sort of invented family therapy. The basic idea there was that psychotherapy, according to Freud and others, was that you had traumatic events in childhood, which
people had trouble coping with. So it was all within the individual. But those who were treating people with mental illness found that you could put a person in the sanitarium and they recover and they get better. You put them back in the family and they relapse. So the idea was, maybe there's something going on in the family. So the idea was to treat the family and the pattern of interactions within the family. And that was the early creation of systems thinking in psychotherapy, the creation of family therapy. But then what Maturana's work did was to elaborate even more thoroughly this neurophysiological view of the construction of reality. And the emphasis on not the way the world is, but the way we interpret the world. And I think that's what all therapists, good therapists, do, is they try to help patients see that they can interpret their experiences differently, that they are in control of their interpretations. They may not be in control of events, but they can control their interpretations. And I think that's so well accepted now that there's, as far as I know, not much room for addition, but I'm probably behind the times.
If we think about elementary particles in physics, technological possibilities have become very complex, and we now have this weak measurement for it. So it seems that if we change our theory, actually, particles seem to change their behavior. Can you say a word about this?
Not really, no. I'll let Gerhard deal with that one. I agree, you design an experiment, you get different results. You design a different experiment, you get a different set of results. That's been a very interesting part of...
Well, we have believed in Heisenberg uncertainty,
right.
But now we have dropped it. We always believed the electron had a definite mass, but now we can hear on every corner that we just don't know the mass of the electron. When we really start...
Go ahead.
No, I was just going to comment before. I think everything you said about quantum mechanics was correct, and... Yeah. Actually, it doesn't really apply so much in the other fields.
Yeah.
Much less than it is proposed in many popular accounts, for example.
Yeah.
But a curious twist to this is that you mentioned the term epistemological experimentation by McCulloch, that he used...
Experimental epistemology.
Yeah, experimental epistemology, right? Yeah. And that's exactly the term that also quantum physicists use in order to describe their foundational discussions. So there's a funny merger
coming together
on a meta level, so to speak.
Thank you. Thank you. Yeah.
I wonder what some of the conclusions are in the social science field if you compare the economic theories, which only deal with linear causal relationships, compared to now a theory where you factor in feedback and such, like in reflexivity. Can policymakers still derive on the same or simple conclusions or conclusions at all to make policy? Or is it the theory itself again open to interpretation? And so what's the gain in the end?
Well, let me say a little bit more about economics. George Soros and his group have created something called the Institute for New Economic Thinking. And they've held an annual conference each year for several years. And Soros is promoting his notion of reflexivity theory. And practical people, namely government, financial managers, secretaries of treasury, and so forth, say they have no problem with reflexivity theory. It's the academics that have the problem with it. Some of them say, well, you can't include the observer or you'll get into logical difficulties, self-reference. So we just stay away from it. Another issue in economics is that economics as a field is split politically. You have one group that says government regulation is sometimes necessary, another group that says markets will solve almost all problems. And these two debates, these two groups debate with one another, and each says, I'm right and you're wrong, and I'm right and you're wrong. And it's resolved through the political process. Who gets the ear of the Congress or the White House, and so forth. If you had a reflexive view of economics and economic theory, then you could say that, if you remember those little heads, the four heads in a social system, that some of them believe one thing and some of them believe another, and then they compete for political influence. And then through the political process, one idea is used more than another for a time, and then the other idea is used more than another for a time. And reflexivity theory deals with that debate, basically by moving it into the political realm, or to political science, if you want. And that, I think, is a very good example of the fact that theories really do influence consequences in social systems. If they didn't, you wouldn't have such emotional debates between the two camps that support government regulation or not. I hope that in some way addresses your question.
Yeah, I think, okay, yeah. That with this way of thinking or theory, I think you're saying you can discuss the institutions even behind
sure.
to make up policies.
Absolutely. Like,
because what you wouldn't have been able or practically be able before.
Well, institutions are a way of sort of locking in a political advantage. That's what the book Who Stole the American Dream is about, is that the lobbyists, or the people who have the most lobbyists and who spend the most on lobbying, win more legislative battles than the people who spend less money on lobbying. And that is what has caused the dramatic increase in inequality in the United States, because business is outspending labor by 16 to 1, 60 to 1, something like that. It's outrageous lobbying activities.
Maybe I come in with the question which I asked at the beginning
yes.
already. Why so little second-order cybernetics in this wonderful book on cybernetics and cybernetics?
Because
why was it only you? You are the thing which is the only one.
Well, I don't remember that I mentioned second-order cybernetics in my article. What I read... The title of the article... the title of the article was On Making a Scientific Revolution, because I was influenced by Kuhn, and I said, okay, let's make a scientific revolution, it'll be fun, and we might learn something along the way. But the reason there wasn't much mention of second-order cybernetics was because Heinz probably came up with the idea when he was writing the cover page. It was in 1974 that he did that. So, in a sense, he was saying all of this is second-order cybernetics. But it hadn't been developed at the time. It started in 1974.
How can you stay more in the second-order cybernetic state? Don't you change in the first or the cybernetics position immediately by being the observer of the second order?
The way Heinz explained it was that if you're observing something and you describe some observed system, that's first order cybernetics. If you use what you've learned and bend it back to understand yourself, that's second order cybernetics. Or if you attempt to understand your position in society, that would also be a kind of reflexive second-order idea. There has been debate about third-order and so forth. I think second-order, which basically goes from description to self-reference, is sufficient. But you can have either at the individual level or at the societal level. But you can have multiple levels of the society. So you can have a group or a firm or a nation or the world. In each case, you're trying to think about the consequences of your activity or the organization's activity on the larger society. And that's, I think, what second-order cybernetics is about. It's a kind of re-entry. It's a higher-level thinking, if you want to think of it that way. But also, I think, it's a way of saying there's more to cybernetics than you think. There's second-order cybernetics. See, there's something more to it than that. So take another look at it. And that's what we've been saying for a long time. That most people think cybernetics is feedback systems. Or they think it's the work of Norbert Wiener, and Wiener died in the 1960s, so why are you still using that term? But the American Society for Cybernetics has been meeting for 50 years trying to develop these ideas. And then you have all the work in Vienna and Europe and so forth. So many people have been developing these ideas for a long time. For some reason, we've done a very poor job of promoting the field in the U.S. But I think the answer to why is that Americans just don't have a philosophical orientation. They evaluate ideas on the basis of their practical consequences, on their applications. Europeans like to think about larger theories. They remember the Kant said there's nothing as useful as a good theory. And Popper said the best theory is the most general theory because it's more easily falsified. Americans don't think that way. So they don't look for more general theories.
My question goes to back to economics. I wonder what would be the added value if you bring in this perspective of second order cybernetics in this whole debate in between mainstream economics and more radical left wing economics. If you just if you have an interpretation of the financial crisis, everybody knows that financial markets, for example, are not efficient, but it didn't help very much to see that one theory was not proven by empirical evidence. So to bring in the perspective of the observer, in this case, I suppose it's the scientific community on the one side and the other side, the different schools. So what could be the added value if to bring in this perspective of the observer looking at economic data?
Well, one of the things that the INET group, the SARS group, the Institute for Economic Thinking, they're trying to reintroduce the history of economic thought to economic curricula. I was talking to an assistant professor at my university that said she never studied the history of economic thought when she got her PhD, and they don't teach it at my university. And there are people out there studying economics who've never heard of Keynes. All they know is neoclassical economics. It's basic, and she explained to me, we're not interested in economic phenomena. What we are doing is practicing a method. It's mathematical analysis.
Econometrics.
It's like operations research. It started off being the improvement of operations in firms, and then it became algorithm development. There's a strange attractor in mathematics. It seems to draw academics in, and then you have to reinvent the field under a different name, doing the practical thing. And there are enough people in economics now who are promoting the reintroduction of the history of economic thought into economic curricula. And if you have that, then you say, okay, there was this idea and it had this effect, and then there was this idea and it had this effect. And that's what we want. You have to have a time sequence in a field to see the consequences of ideas. If it's just mathematical analysis, you don't have that.
If I think back to 42, I still have the impression that second-order cybernetics has the origin in Gregory Bateson's ideas and Ronald Blaine's concept of you have two persons and one has an image of the other and the other has an image of the observer and the observer has an image of the observed observer and so on it goes. And this whole interactionism in sociology seems to come close to this idea.
Yeah, I think so. Boulding's notion of the image was a very... Kenneth Boulding wrote a book called The Image, which was very influential. I think it came out in 56. So a lot of these ideas have been around for a while under different names.
Are there any more questions, comments? So, I mean, it would be sad if we would stop already at this point. We are officially allowed to be longer here. maybe there's an incentive. And Stuart doesn't have to leave early in the morning, so that's another.
No, I'd like to have a question, although it's so brave that it's taking for me to ask the question or dare to ask the question. You said there's this real big possibility of changing philosophy of science through second order cybernetics. But there's a saying in economy, the best way to die out is to have a rising share in a dying market. Is the philosophy of science a dying market itself, or can it promote itself so that the rising share that cybernetics could have in that market actually means something to a global market? Or have you a strategy, thought of a strategy, or you know about Carl having developed a strategy of how to do that?
Carl will have to speak to that one.
Next year.
Next year.
Okay.
I spend a lot of time puzzling over that idea and making presentations and trying to be persuasive. And that's basically what I've been doing for many years, is trying to invent different ways of explaining what cybernetics is. And basically I've come to the conclusion, don't use the word. They think it's Dianetics. Or something that's too difficult to understand. And so Carl suggested just call it meta-analysis. I think that was meta-research. And I think that's probably a good idea. Put it in the references, but don't put it in the text.
Because and in neurophysiology, is there... Because there was a starting point, as you say, the most convincing arguments for people to get in the field are the neurophysiological arguments.
Right.
You see a possibility that neurophysiology is very strong now at the moment, that they reach back to their beginnings and reinvent Heinz von Foerster in that way.
You know, the really interesting thing is that they haven't done that. It's like, when Heinz was doing his neurophysiological stuff, the technology was extremely primitive relative to today. But they came up with really very powerful insights, which the more modern methods of today don't comment on. It's like, and I think this is because Europeans have greater philosophical understanding. There's realism and idealism as epistemologies. In the United States, there's only realism and error. Okay. So anyone who takes a subjectivist approach is obviously doesn't understand the philosophy of science. That was my reaction when I first heard Heinz speaking. And it was the neurophysiological arguments that brought me around to that position. Now, when I cite those neurophysiological arguments, and I can go through them if you want, my students are persuaded. And they say, wow, that's really interesting. And then they go back to doing whatever they were doing before. So I think it's a very useful set of arguments to make. But the ambient culture in the United States is different from in Europe. See, in Europe, philosophy is the queen of the sciences. It's the origin of the sciences. In the United States, philosophy is one of the humanities. It's sort of like medieval French literature. And similarly useful. So it's like, you just don't study that stuff. Well, maybe if you want to become a lawyer, you know. But if you ask people, who was the first economist, they'll say Adam Smith. Well, what was Adam Smith's job? He was a moral philosopher. Americans don't know that. So, before the sciences, there was philosophy in Europe. But in the United States, somebody just started the sciences from scratch. It's a failure of the educational system.
I found an American mathematician. His name is Lou Kaufman.
Yeah.
Who is founding much of mathematics with philosophy.
Yeah.
And I found that some people in Vienna don't understand him.
Oh, well.
But this is just for fun. But you have people in America who do philosophy, but their theory is not practiced a lot. So I think the mathematics of Lou is really very advanced.
Oh, yeah.
I did not mention him, but he really brought in self-evidence into mathematics.
Yeah.
And it really works.
Yes.
But people just don't know it. Nowhere.
Yeah, I'm working on an article with Lou on self-reference.
That's awesome.
Yeah. He's one of the cyberneticians. It's a small group.
Who really knows?
Yeah, very well. You want me to walk you through the neurophysiological experiments? If you've heard them, that'll be boring. But if you haven't...
If you do it quickly and profound, then...
Okay. Does everybody know the blind spot? Okay.
Why doesn't it come up?
If you hold a sheet of paper in front of yourself and you close one eye. And this is viewing your head from the top, so you have two eyes and so forth. You focus on the object at the left, then there will come a time when the object on the right will disappear if you move the sheet of paper slowly in and out. And the reason that happens is that that image falls here, where the optic nerve leaves the retina. There are no receptor cells, so you don't see anything. There's nothing to be stimulated. And so the brain fills it in with the surrounding color of the paper. So the dot just disappears. But if you look out to the world, you don't see any black holes. Now, there are many other things, ways that the brain helps you that you're not aware of. Reversing top and bottom. If you listen to somebody giving a lecture who speaks with an accent, you have to listen very closely in the beginning. But after 10 minutes, 15 minutes, you're not listening as hard as you were before because your brain has learned an algorithm. and you're hearing them without working so hard at it. If you go to a cocktail party and you're trying to decide which group to talk to, then you can listen to this group, or you can listen to that group, or you can listen to this group, and they say, well, this one sounds most interesting, so you join that group. Now, those sound waves striking your eardrums combine all of those conversations and the music, etc. But you can filter out messages and listen to this group or listen to that group. Now, how do you do that? Well, I would submit you don't know how you do it, but you know you can do it, and you do it. So the brain is giving you a lot of help. Another example, you can try this. Move your eyeball within your skull by pressing gently on your eyeball. And you should see the room move. Try it. Okay. Just press gently on your eyeball, and does the room move? Yes? Okay, now assume you're playing American football or rugby or something, and you go out for a pass and you catch the pass, and you shove away some would-be blockers and make a touchdown. Did the stadium move? Well, you're getting banged around a lot, but the stadium was stationary. Nevertheless, a very slight movement of your eye and your skull, and the room jumps around a lot. So what the brain is doing is taking messages from your eyes and your skeleton and integrating them to compute a stable reality. Another example. Two kittens. The experimental apparatus was a wagon with a sort of T-bar and two canvas bags at the end of it. And you put the two kittens in, and one of them, the feet are up. And the other one, the kitten is standing. And you drag them around for some days or weeks. And in one case, the kitten is standing, in the other case, the kitten is up. You take them out of the apparatus and put them on a table. And what happens? Well, one of the kittens walks off the edge of the table. The other one sort of looks over and doesn't walk off the edge of the table. If you put them on the floor, one of them walks normally, the other one bumps into things, like it doesn't see things. Okay, now which kitten is which? Which kitten can walk? The one that was standing. All right, so we can, in a sense, which kitten can see the one that was standing? Because the brain integrates what it sees, and you could conclude from that kittens see with the soles of their feet, which would be an odd conclusion. Here's another example. In wartime, soldiers are wounded. And there was a time, I think, maybe the First World War, some soldiers were shot straight through the head, but they survived. Now, the nature of wounds is that most of the damage occurs at the back of the head, the exit wound, and that's the occipital cortex. That's where you process vision. Now, the odd thing about these soldiers was that they had no trouble seeing, but they walked kind of funny, sort of like drag a foot. But there was no damage to the part of the nervous system that controls walking. And this was a puzzle to the doctors. It made them question their understanding of the structure of the brain. But one day, one of the doctors came to see one of the patients, and he had a clipboard. And he says, "Hi, Joe, how are you?" And patient says, "I'm fine, doc, how are you?" Asked him a series of questions. And then the doctor put away his pen, took out a packet of cigarettes, and said, "Would you like a packet of cigarettes?" And the patient who's looking at him now, since he started talking to him, was looking at the doctor and said yes, but he doesn't reach for a cigarette. So the doctor said, here it is. And the patient's looking at the doctor and says, where? And the doctor says, in my hand. The patient says, no, it's not. The doctor says, what is in my hand? And the patient says, a pencil. And then the doctor knew how to make the patients walk. What was the treatment? Well, they blindfolded them. So you teach them to walk with their ears rather than with their eyes. Okay, if your conception of space is the summation of your muscles and your vision, and your vision is disturbed, then you need to gather additional data on where things are. But you could close your eyes and walk with your ears, the balance mechanisms in your ears, and then your perception of the world is not disturbed because your ears haven't been damaged. So that's what they did. And the patients learned to walk again. And then the doctor said, use your peripheral vision. So this is a very bad diagram, but that's the visual field. In the middle is the blind spot, which has been expanded. This is just a depiction. When the doctor entered the room holding his clipboard, the patient saw him enter the room through his peripheral vision and gathered data. But then when the patient was looking at the doctor, he wasn't really seeing the doctor. He saw part of the doctor, but he wasn't seeing the middle of the visual field. That was all constructed, and hence the notion of the construction of a reality. The brain constructs a reality based on whatever it has access to. And then you can carry that over to the world that we see depends upon our language, our culture, our academic training. We are trained to look at some things and not other things. We see things the way we're accustomed to seeing them. I once went to a game park in Africa, and you drive around in a truck, an open truck, and the guy would say, there's an elephant over there. An elephant is a large animal. And I looked and I didn't see the elephant until it moved. And then I could see it. Or he said, there's some giraffes over there under the trees. I didn't see the giraffes. Turns out they were at the next clump of trees, much farther away. But after a few days, I began to be able to see the animals more quickly. They didn't have to move before I saw them. So you can see things that you're trained to see, and you don't see things that you're not accustomed to seeing. And those are just examples from the neurophysiology of cognition, which helped me to understand what they were talking about when they talked about the construction of reality.
Stuart, this was an impressive conclusion, and thanks a lot for your two presentations, the short one at the end now and the longer one, and hopefully it was interesting for you as well, and hopefully we see each other next year with another Heinz von Foerster conference. Thank you.